Well, let's reward those who are punctual, I guess. My name is Brandon Way. I'm with Aptus, and we're also here joined by Brooke and Gina and Julie and Marge and Danielle. Special guest Mike Tisa there in the corner. And it is our pleasure to put on the event this evening. Thanks so much for joining us. We have Rebecca Pinnell, who is a longtime professional cocktail enthusiast and educator for she's been in the hospitality business for 15 years and behind the bar for 8. And she's going to share with us a very tasty cocktail. But before we begin, I want to remind all of you that we have a couple other events coming up that we hope you will participate in. This Thursday, we have organized a March Madness bracket. If you have not received an invitation and you are interested, please reach out to your local rep and they'll make sure you get an invitation. And also, March 25th at 5:30, we have a great event put on by Dale Carnegie about how to build your virtual presence. And as we all know, that's a pretty critical thing these days that I think anyone can make use of. Hopefully we'll be back in person, but in the meantime, I think that'll be a great event to attend. So with that, thanks again for joining us this evening. And Rebecca, please help us relax with a St. Patty's Day cocktail.
Hi, everyone. I'm so excited to be here. It's just pretty wild. It's been a wild year, but I keep getting to teach classes virtually because you just keep showing up. And so thanks for being here and wanting to learn a few things. I started doing these classes after running some cocktail bars that are quite intense in our preparations for making cocktails. And I decided at the start of teaching these classes that I wanted them to feel approachable. And so to do that, I'm like, let's make a cocktail in under 15 minutes, because that literally is all the time I really want to offer myself to make a drink. So therefore, I'm going to teach you how to do that today. If you want to look at everyone's screen and have it feel more happy hour, you can leave the grid as it is, or if you can scroll over my screen and pin mine so it's larger, just so you're able to see better if that's important to you. And we're going to get started by making a syrup. And we're gonna get started by talking about a few things. Okay, measuring tools. This tool right here is called a jigger. A jigger measures in ounces or milliliters. My jigger is 1 ounce on this side and 2 ounces on this side. And so I'm able to measure out cocktails and also finer, smaller ingredients, because inside of it, I have these rings that show me where like a 1/4 ounce, a 1/2 ounce, and 3/4 of an ounce is. Some people have these really cool glasses or other measuring tools that have like lines on them too, that also give you those smaller measurements. If you're super into making cocktails, having a tool that will give you that like 1/4 ounce measurement is going to be very helpful for making cocktails. So as a side note, that's the tool I'll be using. But what's cool is you don't have to have that kind of measure. You could use a tablespoon and a 1/4 cup measuring cup. It translates perfectly. I'll talk about these measurements throughout class, so you don't have to have this memorized, but a 1/2 ounce thing is 1 tablespoon. And so you could use either tool. So you don't even have to buy anything fancy. You can just have your baking tools at home. So that's first. And now we're going to soon start making a syrup. And to do so, I like to use mason jars to make syrups in. We could totally put the syrup on a stovetop and cook it and let the heat allow the sugars to dissolve, but that causes that's a dirty pan and that's too many steps. Then you also have to wait for the syrup to cool down before you can use it in a cocktail. I can't be bothered. So therefore, I use mason jars to make syrups in. We're going to make a honey syrup today, but and I'll talk about this more later. We're going to use coffee and honey and some spices. We're going to shake it to dissolve it, and we'll have a syrup in moments. You could do the same with white sugar. You don't have to use honey. You could also use cold temperature water and white sugar and some strawberries and shake that together and have strawberry syrup. You don't have to cook it on the stove. You can just put it all in a mason jar, which is a really cool, fun, easy technique. So we're going to make a syrup and we're going to make cocktails. The syrup measurements that I have that I'm adding right now is enough to make 5 cocktails. So you can choose to cut the recipe in half if you'd like to use less ingredients, or you can choose just to make the full portion, have some left over that you can make other cocktails with or add on top of ice cream, delicious, or like in your coffee. A coffee honey syrup in your coffee, stop it, it's so good. So we're gonna make our syrup in a mason jar. So grab a mason jar if you have it. You can use a Tupperware container. You could also use your shaking vessel if that's what you prefer. what we're going to do, what's cool about using mason jars too is there's a measuring line on my mason jar for a half of a cup. If you want to make this the full portion, which will make 5 cocktails, half cup of honey, half cup of cold coffee. If you want to cut the recipe in half, then just cut the recipe in half and you'll be able to make like 2 to 3 cocktails, just as a side note. So I'm going to make half the recipe because I have a fridge full of syrups. So I'm going to use a quarter cup personally. So a quarter cup or a half cup of honey. You could either just pour it in the mason jar if you have the lines. If you don't have those lines, you can use a measuring cup. Before you put the honey in the measuring cup, spray it with like some cooking spray, and that will keep the honey from sticking. It'll slip right out. Or if you have the lines on your mason jar, that works out even better, and you can just pour it. I also take the cap off of my honey so that I don't have to like squeeze it. It takes a lot of effort to use your forearm to squeeze the honey out of the pour spout. So I just pour right from the top, put the cap back on. It can get a little sticky, but boom. So I have right now, because I'm making the recipe in half, I'm doing a quarter cup honey. You could do a quarter or half. And then the next ingredient is going to be the same portion in coffee. I have this giant vessel of cold brew. Basically, you just need cold coffee. It doesn't have to be cold brew. You're looking for the same portion. So I'm going to use a quarter cup, but you can use a half if you're doing the bigger portion. So coffee, cold brew. Cold brew is made by infusing coffee into water that's cold. And what that does is the coffee flavors pull into the water slowly, which causes the coffee to be less bitter and softens the flavors of the coffee through this slow process of making coffee. That's why I call it cold brew. Slow brew is what I would call it. It's sort of like making, you know, sun tea. You ever make sun tea? I love sun tea, where you like put bags of tea in the cold and you put it in the sun and let the sun warm it up and pull the flavors out. By doing a cold version or a slow version, it's going to keep things from being tannic and bitter. That's what the benefit of cold brew is. It's delicious. So in your vessel, equal portions of coffee and honey, and then grab some sort of spoon and let's just start the process of dissolving the honey into the liquid. So I have a tall bar spoon, but any sort of vessel will work. And you can just kind of stir the honey just enough to get the honey to start dissolving. And then once you feel like the liquid and the honey have kind of united, you can stop. It doesn't have to be fully dissolved because we're also going to shake this to dissolve. So just get most of it to feel like it's dissolving. Try to get the honey off the end of the spoon. So what we're making is a coffee syrup. You could literally make this with white honey if you prefer. You could use brown sugar, really whatever liquid you'd like. But it usually for simple syrups, the recipe is equal portions sugar and liquid. Honey syrups usually are 2 portions honey to 1 portion liquid. But because I wanted to make our coffee syrup especially delicious, I've chosen to do what's called equal parts. When you're making these syrups too, you can use other liquids, pomegranate juice, apple juice, you could use tea, you could just use plain water. So the making syrups, it's really fun. You can just substitute different liquids or different kinds of sugar and have a different syrup. Additionally, I forgot what I was going to say. I was like so stoked on this idea and it just like went. So here we go. We have coffee. Oh, honey. The reason why we have to dilute honey is because honey is so viscous. If I was to squeeze honey into my shaking vessel, add ice and try to shake with it, the honey would solidify. So it's really helpful to dilute the honey with some liquid. So it's in a liquid form so that it can emulsify into the ingredients. So that's why we use honey syrups in our cocktails instead of just plain honey. Liquefying it makes it a little bit easier to work with. All right, we're going to now add cinnamon, salt, cayenne, and cream. So cinnamon is going to be to the tune of half teaspoon of cinnamon. And if you're making it in half portion, make sure you cut that in half. Half teaspoon of cinnamon. Since we're talking about spice, after you do your half teaspoon of cinnamon, You have the option of adding some cayenne pepper to your syrup. This is kind of a fun little layer of flavor that's like sort of unexpected, and that's why I quite like using this in the cocktail. If you like cocktails that are a little spicy, you kind of enjoy spice in those ways, adding a shake or two of cayenne pepper will add this layer of spice that will hang out in the back of the palate after you've sipped the cocktail. I like spicy food, so I find this amount of spice to be not spicy at all. If you are spice sensitive, then maybe don't put the spice in your syrup at all, because I would hate for it to be spicy for you. So I'm going to add two dashes of cayenne pepper to mine, because I kind of want it to be a little spicy. It's a really fun addition. You could also opt to not add the spice right now, and then try the cocktail and put a small splash on top if you wanted, so you don't have to commit to it with the syrup. A few options. Spice is an anti-inflammatory. It helps with sore throats if you're ever sick. Cayenne pepper, lemon, and honey. That's what I would drink behind the bar when I would have a sore throat. It works really well. All right, now we're going to add 2 pinches of salt. I'm using kosher salt. You can use white table salt if you'd like. You could use pink Himalayan sea salt. It does sort of matter in certain contexts, but in this context, it's totally fine. Just using the 2 pinches of salt is perfect. Now, there's a few people that have joined since I've started, and I'm going to paste. I'm going to put the recipe in the chat again. So for those of you who just joined, I've just replaced the recipe that we're making. And someone has their hand raised. Does somebody have a question? Cool. You can unmute yourself and ask questions or write them in the chat as well.
Rebecca?
Oh, yeah.
I just want to mention to everyone, since we have more people attending now, that if anyone wants to pin your video and make your video the dominant image, and you can right click on Rebecca's image and pin the video, and that'll give you a bigger view of what she's doing there.
That's perfect. Thank you for that. Yeah. And if you just joined, in the chat is the recipe. It's pretty easy to follow. Let me know if you have any questions. So the last thing, if you'd like to, you could add Irish cream to this recipe. Irish cream is Bailey's Irish cream. I'm using Caroline's Irish cream because they didn't have any Bailey's in my neighborhood. I went to several markets and couldn't find it, but this will be just as delightful. If you'd like to add another layer of flavor to your syrup, you could add 1/2 ounce or 1 tablespoon of Irish cream right into the syrup, and that's going to just bring, it's going to just make the syrup more delicious. And if you decide to ever pour this over ice cream or add it to coffee and like use it outside of the cocktail, it's real special. And that's the final ingredient. Oh, the reason why we added salt to our recipe is because salt balances bitter. It's sort of like sweet and acid balance each other out. If something's too sweet, add some acid, it'll lower the sugars. If something's kind of bitter, add some salt, it'll soften those bitter tones. That's why you see like salt on dark chocolate. It works so well together. Salt and coffee work really well together because it balances things out. Adding 2 pinches of salt to our syrup it's not going to make it salty. It's like cooking with salt. It'll just add these layers of flavor and let everything have a space to like be highlighted and shown. Now we're going to attach the lid to the mason jar, and we're just going to shake this liquid to fully dissolve the sugars into the liquids. I like to play a little music. If you don't have a mason jar or a lid, you can stir it, but shaking it is really fun because we're going to make a little dance. Now, I know this isn't Irish, but because we're working with Irish cream, Cream makes me think of this song. Where is it at? Oh, there it is. You ready?
My milkshake brings all the boys to the yard, and they're like, it's better than yours. Damn right, it's better than yours. I could teach you, but I have to charge. My milkshake brings all the boys to the yard, and they're like, it's better than yours. Damn right, it's better than yours. I could teach you, but I have to charge.
I always feel so sad to cut it off. I don't think I've listened to that full song in a hot minute. my brain needs me to hear the whole thing, you know? And maybe later you all will do the same. So there you go. That's how easy it is to make a syrup. Because we were working with honey and we stirred it to get it started to dilute, you don't have to shake it for too long. If we were using white granular sugar, it takes a little bit longer to shake those ones because the sugar needs to dissolve, etc. But this sort of happens pretty quickly. Now you have a syrup. If you'd like to, you could open up your syrup and give it a taste if you feel like it, or you can just put it to the side and we'll get onto it. Yay. So here's a few things about this syrup. The syrup can be refrigerated. It needs to be refrigerated. It lasts for about 10 days. Thumbs up. You like the syrup? It's pretty cool, right? Yeah, it's so yummy. Yeah, it's delicious. This will last for about 10 days in the fridge. What you're looking for is mold or fermentation. If the vessel hisses at you when you open it, it's fermented. It will taste gross. Don't drink it. Like, it won't make you sick. It just will be really unfortunate. If you want to make your syrups last longer, I have two ideas for you. One, you could add alcohol to the syrup. Adding a little bit of alcohol, like 2 tablespoons per half cup of liquid, that will keep the bacteria from growing and it'll stabilize your syrup, making it last for a month, maybe two. Or you could freeze your syrup in cubes. Imagine this like frozen in cubes. You could just add one to your coffee if you wanted. Or this is a fun idea too for this flavor profile. If you're a person who drinks tequila, rum, or whiskey on the rocks, put 2 regular ice cubes and 1 frozen cube of this syrup. And as you sip it slowly, as your hand warms the glass, the cube will slowly melt, which will add a very faint flavor of the syrup. It's kind of cool. All these notes are added in a PDF I created for the class. So you don't have to have any of this memorized. It will all be sent to you. All right, who's ready to drink? I'm ready to drink. Let's go. All right, so if you're making this cocktail without alcohol, it's quite easy. It's a 1, 2, 3. There's the recipe there. The concept is the same, so you can wait to join us to make it, or you can move ahead, whatever, however you feel, really. And if you make it with alcohol, the alcohol version's in the chat now. I'm gonna demonstrate the alcohol version, but again, they're made in the same way. So my syrup I'm gonna put to the side, and now I'm going to grab my empty shaker. I'm using metal shaking tins called Boston shaking tins, which is the two-part shaker. The two-part shaker, the smaller shaker is where I'm gonna build my cocktail in, not the larger one. That's just so that way I don't overflow it and it makes sure it seals. So I build in the smaller tin. If you're using a cobbler shaker, that's great. You can use mason jars, you can use Tupperware, whatever you'd like to do. We're going to put a whole bunch of liquid in here. We're going to fill it with ice and we're going to shake it. The reason why we're going to shake it with ice is to emulsify the ingredients, to combine them. And also we want to foam and froth up the milk and the coffee. It's gonna get all frothy and foamy if you shake it well, which is really fun. So we can start from the top. Let's do 2 ounces of alcohol. I have this cute little flask of Jameson I'm gonna use. Someone was saying they bought a big bottle, yeah? Is that? Oh, amazing. You are not gonna run out anytime soon. I love it. Now, you could make this Irish by using Irish whiskey. The Irish coffee is literally sugar, Irish whiskey, coffee, and cream, like whipping cream. That's the Irish coffee. And so that's how you could use. But this recipe tastes delicious with tequila or rum as well, or bourbon. So, and you could use vodka if you'd like, but I really prefer like the other spirits because it has more texture. But few options. 2 ounces of alcohol, which is the same as 1/4 cup. 2 ounces or 1/4 cup of alcohol. That's going to go right into the empty shaker. And that's the common pour. When you order a cocktail from me at a bar, that is how much you will receive alcohol from me in a cocktail. So it's a very common pour. Okay. Oh, the formatting's wrong. Okay, now grab that coffee. Not the syrup, but the coffee. The same coffee you use to make the syrup with. We're looking for 1 ounce, which is 2 tablespoons. So the coffee, not the syrup. The coffee, plain coffee, 2 tablespoons or 1 ounce. Boom. Because we want to make sure this tastes like coffee, right? Nothing says it's perfect. 6 p.m. coffee hour. I'm into it. San Francisco time. So 2 tablespoons of the plain coffee, which is 1 ounce. And then the last ingredients is going to be 1/2 ounce or 1 tablespoon of Irish cream or milk. If you didn't get Irish cream for this and you're just using milk, you could do either or. Irish cream or milk, 1/2 ounce or 1 tablespoon. Oh, delicious. I love Irish cream. Anybody like a big fan of Irish cream? Yeah. I don't think I've ever purchased a bottle of Irish cream, and I'm really stoked that I have this now. Check your bottle too. Depending on the label, you might have to refrigerate it. I don't think so though. Mine does not need to be refrigerated. I have Carolines, but just make sure you just read the label to see if you have to specially refrigerate yours. It's usually fine because there's alcohol content and the way it's processed makes it stable, but just make sure you check your label because I'd hate for it to go bad. All right, 1/2 ounce or 1 tablespoon of the Irish cream or milk. And then now you're gonna use that syrup, 1/2 ounce or 1 tablespoon, that special syrup you made. You'll see there's tons left over. You're gonna be able to have a whole bunch of delicious beverages with that syrup. And that's the final ingredient. Now we're going to fill our shaker all the way to the top with ice. The more ice you add to your shaker, the more the colder your cocktail will be, which means your ice will dilute less. More ice, colder cocktail, less diluted. That's how that works. So if you have enough ice in your house, fill your shaker all the way to the top with ice, part of the noise. And this cocktail, classically, in my vision, would be served in a stemmed glass, preferably one with a green stem. Look at that, Jim. I got this for $1 at my local thrift store. I know. Isn't that great? Classically, we would serve this in like a stemmed glass. And if you'd prefer a rocks glass, like a bucket glass that like you hold with your hand, if you're choosing to drink a cocktail out of a glass that doesn't have a stem, put ice in that glass too. Because my hand is touching the glass, that's going to cause the ice to melt or the cocktail to get warm. So stemmed glass is ideal. If you're using a rocks glass, put ice in that glass. You'll notice that Gina has her glasses right out of the freezer. She's taken a class before. She knows. A cold cocktail in a cold glass is magic. My freezer is on the opposite side of my house, so unfortunately I don't get to do that. But I strongly encourage cold cocktail, cold glass. All right. Add the lid to your shaker. And now we're going to shake our cocktail. We shake cocktails to emulsify the ingredients and to make the cocktail cold. And you want it to shake it properly, you want to kind of go up and down or side to side. Focus in on it this way. The liquid and the ice is on one side. You want to move all that liquid and ice to one side and then back again in very quick manners. Up and down. Exactly. So up and down or side to side. It just depends on what feels good to your body. And of course, let's just dance to another song, right? This is the radio cleaner version. So we're going to just go with it.
Don't make me leave me with my foot in your be cool. And don't worry about you think I'm tricking. Well, I ain't tripping. I'm buying if you got nice curves for your iceberg. Bringing here, I'm not going to like you do something to me. Hope this indecent proposal. Watch yourself. Shake your face. Show me what you're working.
There it is. So now we're going to strain our cocktail into a glass. If you shake it like well and properly in that sort of movement, you will elongate the milk and coffee, having like a little bit of a white froth on top, which is really beautiful. You can strain this cocktail directly from the strainer on your shaker if you'd like. If you have this tool here, this is called a Hawthorne strainer. It has a spring on it. Put the spring inside the shaker. The spring fits in the shaker. That's going to keep the ice from falling out. And then the fine mesh strainer is going to, if you want to do what's called double straining, you can hold a fine mesh strainer over your glass and strain the liquid through both strainers. And that's going to keep out small ice chips and any other weird particulate that may have gotten into your drink, which will make your cocktail just taste much smoother. Not imperative, just it's just a technique I use in my bars. This is called double straining. And you can do it with the lid to your strainer, or you can use the Hawthorne strainer. If you're having a hard time getting the liquid to move through the lid to your strainer, that happens a lot because there's ice and liquid, it's hard. It might be valuable to purchase a spring strainer because it makes the cocktail come out much faster, just as a side note. And that's it. If you'd like to, I got some green sprinkles for the party. I don't think I told you to get green sprinkles, but you can just do a little green sprinkle. Oh, come on. That's just too stinking cute. I can't take it. So there you go, green sprinkles on the tops, because why not? Or you know what would be really fun too, like edible glitter if it was green? That could be also very charming and delightful. But mostly let's just get this drink to our lips. Let's say cheers. It's so nice to be here hanging out with y'all. Okay, it's not a competition. When you have a moment, I'd love for you to unmute. I'd love to hear your experience. Here's a few notes about this cocktail and all cocktail recipes. Recipes are flexible. Everyone wants a different cocktail in their hand. Sometimes you want it sweeter. Sometimes you want it not as sweet, more savory, more sour. So if this recipe is just not sweet enough for you, that's great. Like that's your palate. Add some more of that delicious syrup by like a half tablespoon. And then it's going to elevate it. It's going to make it a little bit sweeter. If this cocktail's too sweet for you, either make it with less syrup or switch out milk instead of the Irish cream. Because Irish cream can be quite sweet. And so you could just use milk instead, which would keep it from being too sweet. So a few options you can kind of just adjust by adding more or less sugar. Work has just the smallest amount of Irish cream, so it's like basically alcohol-free. Important to know, use a lot of ice when you shake your cocktails. That's going to combine the ingredients, emulsify them, and make your cocktail cold. And so use a lot of ice when you make your cocktails. It'll taste better if you do that. And use if you're using a stemmed glass, if it's cold, it'll taste better. If you're drinking out of a rocks glass, put new ice in the rocks glass. Don't use the ice you shook with. If you're using the ice that you shook with, that ice broke down into small pieces. It's going to have an unfortunate texture. So I always use fresh ice in a glass and strain my cocktail into that. Just so my cocktails have more refinement. You can do what you want. You're drinking at home. There's no judgment, but that's just what we do behind the bar. And that's why our cocktails taste better.
Will you show how to use that spring-loaded contraption again? I saw them in my parents' estate and I didn't know what they were for.
Yeah, so they're called Hawthorne strainers. They're an original kind of strainer. And what it is, the spring just fits inside the shaker.
Oh.
Having a hard time here. They're made this way so that you keep out the big ice and all the chunks and stuff. And that spring sort of helps keep, if we shook a cocktail with mint, for example, this would sort of keep the mint from falling in the cocktail. So fit that spring inside the strainer and then hold your finger in the middle and then wrap your hands around the sides. And that's how you use that. And then double strain the fine mesh strainer, hold that over your glass and then strain through both. I just washed these tins, so there's some water in them, but there you go. Yeah.
So if it didn't come out frothy, is it because of a lack of an ingredient? Did I not shake it vigorously enough?
Yeah. So it could be a few things. It could be the temperature of the coffee. If the coffee is too cold, mine's room temperature. I didn't pull it right out of the fridge. That might make a difference. The freshness of the coffee, when it was brewed last, and if you used milk or Irish cream. Those are a few of the reasons why you wouldn't get the frothiness. If you're using fresh coffee that's room temperature and milk, you're going to get more of a foam.
Okay.
Yeah. And also just make sure you do that movement up and down to get that frothing sort of aerating quality of the cocktail making. Yeah. How many of you think you'd make this cocktail again? Is this sort of something yay, that's good. I love that news.
All right.
And it's so easy, right? You could recreate this in 15 minutes from making the syrup to making cocktails. And that's so important because it means that we'll actually do it,
I don't know if I remember this correctly. So I have one of these, I don't know, whatever things. This is also a measuring thing, right?
It can be. If if you wanted to, you can test it using a tablespoon. A tablespoon is the same as a half ounce. And so you can fill this with water, half ounce, and pour it into that cap. And then see if it levels out. And then you can be oh, this is an ounce. That looks like it would be an ounce.
Right. And usually it's 2 ounces for drinks, right?
2 ounces for a cocktail. Yeah.
Got it.
It could maybe be an ounce and a half. The thing is, they're all made so different and it's really hard to know.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Kim says, where's the sprinkles? I think I forgot to write them on the list. That was my fault. The sprinkles are just an extra touch. But you know what? That's just all the more reason to just keep making this cocktail for the next few days. Go get yourself some sprinkles. And you know what would be fun too? If you're feeling real crafty, you could get a stencil. You could cut out a stencil. Even place a stencil on there, a four-leaf clover and sprinkle around it and have a... Come on.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I love it. You're going to be sent the... you'll be sent the PDF of the recipes and you'll be able to use these recipes over and over again. My Instagram handle will be on there as well. Rebecca's Cocktail Classes. I also just added in the chat the PDF. So if you'd like to just save that over right now so you have it immediately, you can have it. And Rebecca's Cocktail Classes is my Instagram. If you have any questions, you could reach out to me there. And I'd be delighted to help you drink better at home. Yay.
Always down to drink.
Yeah, I post often. Oh. And they work for Aptus quite a bit too. And then they have other videos, right, Brooke? There's
on YouTube, yeah.
Oh, cool. Mm-hmm.
So Rebecca, do you still do is it Fridays or Mondays or one day of the month? Do you have a class, right?
Yes, I do a cocktail club where you can make more cocktails with me. And I was doing it once a month on a Monday, but I just have rotated the days. I'm going to do it, I think, on Friday next week. I need to make that happen. But if you're interested in joining my cocktail club, it's really easy. Just it's an email sign up. And then you don't get any like spam from it's me, and I'm just going to send you an email once a month and be like, hang out with me if you want, so you can find me there. Someone said they didn't see the PDF. I think it just finally finished loading, if it'll work, and if not, Brooke's going to forward it on to everyone anyway, so you'll have it. And I'm mindful of everyone's time. Thanks for joining and making cocktails with me. Please reach out with any questions, and I get to do this because you show up, so I raise a glass and I say cheers to you. Thanks for being here.